You just changed your logo. I saw your logo being unveiled today by Gautam Chatterjee and Suzanne Khan. What, according to you, does your logo stand for? What is the importance of it?
Thank you, Rajesh, for doing this session. And before I come to the logo and all that, I would like to start to say that I came into real estate only because of one reason. And you all will find this very, very surprising. Me and my elder brother, we are the two siblings for my, from my parents. So my elder brother, my dad sent him to do post-graduation in civil engineering. And, you know, once in 1970s, 80s, when people go to USA, then the chances of their coming back is very, very less. So, you know, I told to myself that I want to live with my parents. So the only way I could live with my parents was to join my father. So honestly, I came to real estate business by coincidence because I wanted to live with my parents. So this is what I would like to begin with to say.
Okay. So Nayan bhai, the objective of our session is going to be anecdotes of your decision making.
Right.
So that the entrepreneurs who learn from your decision making capabilities will implement them in their businesses and become a better entrepreneur.
Right.
So the reason for asking you, why did you change your logo and what do you think about a logo?
Right.
So we will, what the objective should be, Tejas and Nayan bhai, is we will ask short questions and short answers so that we can cover a lot of topics.
Right.
Yeah.
So our brand line is appreciating you. And the triangle covers four colors, earth, air, water, and sun. So what we are saying is that we are, a developer is always wedded to nature. That's why the four colors, that's why the triangle. That's where the motivation comes from.
Why did you change it now?
Because we felt that after Narendra Modi's governance, the entire spectrum of corporate governance has changed. And appreciating you are the two words in which we are trying to tell the whole world that we love you, we appreciate your relationship, and if you were to become my customer, the value of your home will appreciate.
Tejas, what do you mean by a brand? What does the word brand sound of to you as an entrepreneur?
See, because I am from a background of real estate, I somehow feel that real estate brand as a subject is yet to evolve in our industry. And I feel somebody who has been there for 30, 40 years, delivered some amount of like 40, 50 lakh square feet can be termed as a brand. Rest all, I think, is an evolution of marketing, which time and again will come and fade. So, because real estate is a highly, you know, you look at it, a very long-term business. I take a decision today, it's like, you know, sometimes it is even, you know, bad than marriage. You know, you take a decision and you live with it for 5, 7, 10 years, the same decision. Within which you take 20 more decisions, but that one decision of taking a plot or not, or taking a, you know, so I think branding is a very serious subject in real estate, you know, and it is yet to be evolved as a subject for us developers and other stakeholders. I think it's a very large concept. I mean, if you look at Hindustan Lever, you can other brands, they are there since 100 years. I think branding has to be looked at from that angle, that how many years they have been there, done that, kind of a thing.
In your line of business, what are your core actions going to be in terms of the process of brand building for your brand?
Very simple. I look at the whole aspect from two things. One is what my dad taught me is, if you can build homes for people who cannot buy it, then stay in this business. So I believe that if you, and people talk about scaling up, I think the only way to scale up is you create a purpose of your life which is larger than your own self. And if you connect yourself to that, that's the only way to scale up. That's
how do
one
you
thing.
Ensure that what you're talking happens on the ground?
What we're actually doing is I'm putting a lot of effort. I'm a civil engineer. I've spent my life 4 to 5 years on site. I have seen every single corner, right from the material dumping to material selection to testings and to concreting and to checking the formwork to everything. We've done, you know, standing in the heat of the sun and doing it yourself. What we're doing it is that we are trying to pass on the philosophy in terms of training, repeated hammering with my team. So I think once the core changes of people, the way they look at it, the customer. So I look at with the customers with a lot of empathy and not as a as a fruit. I look at it as an empathy. So what I do on ground is we have a meeting every day, every Monday for 4 hours with training session that I take with an entire organization. So that the heart and soul of the organization, the DNA of the organization goes to the event, to the office boy, to the driver, to everybody. Like, so that's how I want.
So Nayan bhai, you believed in transparency much before RERA came into the picture and all the other acts came into the picture. You were one of the first guys in Mumbai or probably in India who started selling by the concept of the carpet area that a customer is going to buy. What are the differentiators between you and the other players in the same industry in terms of customer management?
Number one, complete transparency. Delivery of the product on the day, date, time. Number three, treating your customer really as your God. I have my customer over here, Mr. Gurshanani, you know, so he knows about it. So for me, and I tell my son, my wife, my mom and my staff, ke inhone ghar kharida na, to tere ko pagar mil saka. Inhone ghar kharida, to mera ghar chal raha hai. Inhone ghar kharida, to meri company chalti hai. So how do you manage in a very simple way, in a very simple communication to your people? I tell the people from NAR ke my dad started as a real estate agent. Broker builder ko karodpati kar sakta hai aur broker builder ko sadakpati kar sakta hai.
How do you adapt to the changes in the industry? Every industry is always volatile all times, especially in a developing country like India. So when a change happens, what are your strategies to adapt to those changes, like the current changes which have happened, like GST, demonetization, RERA? How do you adapt to those changes and how fast are you? For people who don't know, the first developer to be registered under RERA in this whole country is Mr. Nayan Shah for Mayfair. And that was quite a record which even surprised Gautam Chatterjee, because he did it at 12 o'clock or 1 o'clock in the night. I'm sure he was pre-planned for getting that done. So how quick do you adapt to the changes that happens in the environment?
See, Rajesh, there is an inner part of a company and there is an outside part of the company. I think the inner part of the company has remained the same in the last 53 years. Being true to your stakeholders, appreciating, respecting, loving, giving regards, making your project lovable, likable, enjoyable, beautiful. This is the inner part of Mayfair. This inner part of Mayfair, I think, has never changed and will never change also.
What do you do to make sure that whatever is thought by you and decided by you is also done by the people at the lower rung of your organization?
Very simple, Rajesh. It's very simple. We have to take up only one, two or three things that you have to talk to your staff. When you come with a list of 20 things to do, they get surprised. Ke boss ko priority kya hai? Company ka priority kya hai? So I am very clear. Customer agar aapke paas aata hai, to usse shuru karo ke tere ghar ki chavi tujhe kis din milegi. Very simple. And I tell you ke the day I started announcing the day, that was the easiest day of my life. Jo main ghar pe jaake aaram se so gaya, mere sare team kaam karne lage. Are boss ne to announce kar diya hai, abhi to uski izzat aur company ki izzat daav pe hai. Hum sab kuch karenge.
He has put up a board on all his sites where it goes diminishing by the day on the date of delivery. Do you still do that?
Yeah, we still do that.
So it is a pressure mounting tactic on your subordinates.
Yeah, and it puts everybody together. See, when John F. Kennedy announced that we will put a man on the moon in the next 10 years, the entire country only had one goal. So you know, every entrepreneur has to think of that one single goal. And if you can think of that one single goal, which is difficult, you can take the entire organization, the entire industry. Say, for example, carpet area. Everybody started carpet area. Box pricing. Everybody started box pricing. Transparency. Everybody started transparency. So, you know, you have to think of that one thing. And the moment you think of that one thing and see, is it good for you? Everybody follows.
So, Tejas, how do you be a differentiator in the industry that you are in? How would you want the people to differentiate you from what you do compared to what the others do in the same industry?
Well, what we have done recently is with a sea of change of things that have happened in the last 1 year. What we are trying to, so I was having a problem with my phone and I tend to write a Twitter to Vodafone. I don't call Vodafone, I tweet them and they immediately call back. And I got the response mechanism. There was somebody who heard my grievances. I shouted, I yelled, whatever I did. And then eventually they convinced me what I'm supposed to. And somehow my problems were resolved. I realized that there is no concept of client servicing or customer servicing in real estate. It's either sales or back office, or it is site, or it is finance or accounts. A customer service department was somewhere missing. The same, either the sales people in a crisis situation or the CRM or the back office used to manage. So what I did was I hired people from such background and created a customer service department, which is actually directly reporting to me with a separate email ID from the customers to me. So now we are sending SMSs every day to the customers. We are calling those projects which are delayed and to call all the customers and give them a feedback that delayed by so-and-so date. And anybody who wish to meet me, I'm available to meet them. So I've kept a target of people to them saying that at least 10 people should meet me a week. Rather than, you know, giving a target that they should not meet me, I did it reverse. Let me meet them. Because customer can be the best feedback mechanism you can have to improve yourself. See, we are a very nascent, small and young organization. I am probably the eldermost in the entire company.
What is the mechanism that you have for your customer feedback?
That's what I'm saying. 3 times a day, each customer receives an SMS for the this thing. And all the projects that are delayed, they have a weekly target to call every customer. There is a complaint or an issue or a question or a query that is pending. Within 7 days, that department has to close it and send it to me. Every week, we do reconciliation of whatever has been pending. The customer is called back and told that we have been pending and we'll take 3 more days or 4 more days. That's how we do it. And those customers who cannot get satisfied by any of them, I am willing, open. So I have an open door policy. Anybody can come and meet me. It's a pretty transparent way. You know, people come and meet me without appointment. There's nothing like that. So even if I have to work till 10, 12, whatever at night. So I keep it very open to learn from the customers as a feedback. And there are several things customers have told me. And I realized that ye to maine kabhi becha hi nahi. Lekin unhone ye dekh ke kharid liya. I mean, I can even realize ki acha acha. I could have sold this also, like in my own project. So these are the things which come as this thing. So, but I am not looking at from that perspective. I'm looking at that a customer deserves an answer, and his money is there in my account. So I am answerable, and I obviously they deserve an answer, and I'm supposed to stand there and deliver an answer.
Delegation happens in your organization like in every other organization. How do you do it differently in your organization?
Very simple, Rajesh. To begin with, the person who meets the customer is the owner of the company. And that's absolutely clear in my organization. That's rule number 1. That's rule number 2. And that's rule number 3. Very simple. The guy who meets the customer is the owner of the company.
So you delegate only responsibility or you also empower him with authority?
Absolute authority. Once in a while, honestly, I don't have a customer service department. I tell the entire company is the customer service department. And I am the head of the customer service. Point number 2, when any guy calls up saying, hey, sir, ye leakage hua hai or anything. So I tell my engineer, yaar ek baat bata, ye ghar teri behen ne agar kharida hota, aur leakage hai, तो तुझे कैसा लगता कंपनी के लिए?
So you are a very philosophical entrepreneur.
So I tell
you. You get into philosophy or giving examples to your team.
Yes. So I said के तो तू क्या करेगा? तू थूक पट्टी करके 6 महीने के बाद तो अपुन चले जाने वाले वो करेगा? या ऐसे काम करेगा कि 10 साल तक कंप्लेन नहीं आएगी? Then he pauses and says, sir, मैं दूसरा करूँगा. मैं तो यही समझ कि तेरी बहन ने लिया है. ये मत सोच, हम लीकिंग रूफ का पैसा नहीं ले सकते. हम खराब टाइटल का पैसा नहीं ले सकते. Jo chahiye, we have to deliver him a clear, marketable title, well-constructed home. Ye standard hai. Ab iske andar sab aa gaya.
Pricing is a very challenging subject in every industry. If you price it high, you don't sell. If you price it low, you're cutting on your profits. How do you arrive at pricing on a launch of a particular project?
I have a different philosophy to pricing. My dad was a salesman of years and years to go. My dad was in real estate since 77. So, and he was a very, very strong salesperson and heading company like Ajmera in sales. So, I feel that, it is not me who decides the pricing. It is not the customer. It's the price at which it sells. It is very important, and it is very important to find that out. So, So at times it happens that, you know, I'm making a very dream project with a lot of amenities. I'm giving so many things. It's a high rise. And I kind of get into the I can't say ego, but get into the euphoria of the project and then price it that way. But I somehow believe that neither the location, nothing. What derives the pricing is the price that it sells. And that is the key point.